You can insure almost anything if you know the right people. You can insure your fantasy football team or your own kidnapping. You can insure the weather or the cash prize for your hole-in-one contest. Australian cricket player Merv Hughes insured his mustache for $775,000, and Project Runway's Heidi Klum had her legs insured for $2 million. Not $1 million each, by the way. Lloyd's of London actually determined that her right leg is slightly more valuable than her left leg. Did you need to know that? No, but I needed to tell you. Now, insuring a leg might be tricky, but if you're looking for some of the most complicated insurance policies in the world, or just slightly outside of the world, look no further than satellites. To understand how exactly you might go about insuring something as niche and expensive as a satellite, we need to talk about how insurance works in the first place. The first thing to know about insurance companies, and I hate to be the first one to break this to you, is that their job is to make money. And in order to make sure that they're not forking over more money than they're raking in, these companies need to accurately assess the likelihood that any given policy they've sold will be claimed. This is done with a process called underwriting, where an insurance company will create a statistical model of whatever it is that they're insuring, your car, your home, your pair of Heidi Klum's legs, and determine the chance that that thing will be destroyed during the time that it's covered. So let's just take life insurance as an example. An underwriter's job will be to figure out the chance that you're gonna die by looking at stuff like your age, gender, height, weight, blood pressure, cholesterol, medical history, smoking habits, career choice, driving records, history of foreign travel, and whether or not your hobbies include playing Russian roulette with your friends every Friday evening. This lets them put you in one of four categories of risk, with preferred plus meaning that you're one of the healthiest people on earth, and standard being a very polite way of highlighting your special relationship with mortality. Now, selling life insurance isn't all that complicated because people are pretty predictable, especially when you're taking the average of thousands or millions of them. The relevant data is accessible, easy to model, and if worse comes to worse, the payouts don't hurt that badly because people just aren't worth very much. None of these things are true when it comes to satellites, and that's why insuring them is such a risky task. In fact, there have been plenty of years where insurers lost way more than they made because these calculations are just so difficult to pull off. But if you're wondering how they at least attempt to not lose money, here's how it works. Each stage of the satellite's life is covered by a different kind of insurance policy, each geared to the particular risks that the satellite might face during that period. The first is pre-launch insurance, which covers the satellite between the time that it leaves the manufacturing facility all the way up until a few seconds after ignition. This isn't all that different from insuring any other hugely expensive object that needs to be transported to Florida without being destroyed beyond repair. So let's move on to where things get interesting. Launch insurance. Launch insurance covers the satellite for a very brief but very crucial period of time, kicking in as soon as the launch can no longer be aborted, up until the point that the satellite has successfully detached from the launch vehicle in space. Calculating the risks for this type of coverage is almost impossible to do accurately. Most of this hinges on the reliability of the launch vehicle itself, but uh-oh, here comes the International Traffic in Arms Regulations to ruin everyone's fun again. It turns out that the rockets we use to send satellites to space are awfully similar to the rockets we use to send deadly explosives to Afghani weddings, so most of this data is kept very secret. Very few insurers are ever given access to the specifics of a given launch vehicle, and when they are, they usually have to sign a consent decree with the United States allowing them to station government overseers around the clock in the company's offices for years after the fact. Insurers are often left with whatever limited information is in the public domain, and that information usually isn't the best basis for a multi-billion dollar insurance contract. Just as an example, they might be dealing with statistics like this: a rocket that technically has a 100% failure rate. Since they can't actually issue an insurance policy with a 100% chance of failure, they just have to take a stab in the dark. And that's assuming that they know what the launch vehicle even is. Sometimes these contracts are written before a launch vehicle has been chosen, so the underwriters literally just try to guess what rocket might get used and cross their fingers that it's not one of the ones with a 100% failure rate. Now, once the satellite is on its own, a new kind of insurance kicks in: in-orbit insurance. Much like launch insurance, this is not an easy phase to accurately underwrite. Generally, insurance companies will look at satellites built on the same bus, which is just a fancy word for this thing, with similar payloads, and see how long their average lifespans were. They'll also do simulations of satellites that are still in orbit, try to calculate when those satellites will fail, and then use that data to make predictions for satellites that have yet to be launched. To accurately make those predictions, they're going to factor in things like radiation, crazy temperature fluctuations, random solar storms, and any miscellaneous objects that Elon Musk sent up there for fun. That last point is actually why this kind of insurance has been skyrocketing recently, as insurers are getting more and more worried that satellites are going to start crashing into one another, creating a cascading effect of debris that will disrupt many of our critical communication systems and trap humanity on Earth forever. But we still have a few years until that happens, so just keep spending your time watching YouTube videos about how niche insurance policies work. If you want to have slightly more time to watch YouTube videos about how niche insurance policies work, while also managing to eat delicious, healthy, home-cooked meals at a reasonable cost, then boy, do I have a solution for you. In fact, it's the exact solution I personally found to being able to watch more YouTube videos about how niche insurance policies work while also managing to eat delicious, healthy, home-cooked meals at a reasonable cost a few years ago, before they even became our sponsor, and it's called HelloFresh. The concept is pretty simple. You select which meals you want on their app, then the next week, an insulated box shows up on your doorstep with all the ingredients you need to make those meals already measured out and prepped, so you can skip straight to the fun part of cooking. So, usually in 30 minutes or less, you have something with home-cooked quality, but you didn't have to plan your meals out, you didn't have to waste time at the grocery store, and you didn't have to waste time prepping ingredients as much. I've been using HelloFresh since 2020 and have these hundreds of recipe cards to prove it, making delicious meals like this tropical teriyaki pork bowl, and have really appreciated how it unlocks more free time without having to compromise on expensive delivery food or unhealthy frozen meals. If you'd like to try them out, go to HelloFresh.com and use code HAI21 for 21 free meals plus free shipping.